Salamta, fellow Rastafari. This is Wendem Alonso, and we're going to continue with Rastafari Senbit, study number 4, but we're going to focus on chapter 20 now. And Abraham, he takes off, he journeys on into the southern countries, and he goes to Gerar in between Kadesh and Shur. And he enters and, states that, well, he presents himself, and of course, having Sarah aside of him, he introduces himself he introduces Sarah as being his sister. And so for that reason, the king of Gerar, Abimelech, takes Sarah. And now verse 3, we're gonna do a little review over, we're gonna read, I mean, from verse 3 on to verse 6, and this is what takes place. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, "Behold, thou art but a dead man for the woman which thou hast taken, for she is a man's wife." And Abimelech, this is what he responds, but Abimelech had not come near her. And he said, "Lord, wilt thou slay also a righteous man? Said he not to me, she is my sister? And she herself said, he is my brother. In the integrity of my heart and innocency of my hands have I done this." And God said to him in a dream, "Yea, I know that thou didst this in the integrity of thy heart, for I also withheld thee from sinning against me. Therefore suffered I thee not to touch her." And so once again, this is a clear indication of God Elohim showing himself almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing, as we have witnessed during this week's study. And so basically, Abimelech tries to get off in with the case of ignorance. I did this ignorantly. They lied to me. I'm not at fault. And so, the Almighty, he's kind of like he doesn't deny that. He actually confirms it. He's like, "Yep, I know, but it is also I that kept you from coming into her, and therefore sinning against me." And so, we know you did this ignorantly, but it was also I who suffered ye not to lay hand on her, basically. And so, that kind of does away with that ignorant plea. So continuing, if we go on to verse 7, now it reads, "Now therefore restore the man his wife, for he is a prophet." Now, really quickly, this is a pattern that we're going to get to see throughout all of the scriptures. First, Abraham is a man, and now he is introduced as a prophet, and we're getting the indication that the Almighty had set this scenario up to glorify himself in Abraham, his prophet. And so now continuing, it reads, "And he shall pray for thee," because remember, Abimelech is but a dead man. So Abraham the prophet now shall pray for thee, and thou shalt live. So I mean, he's telling it how it's gonna be before it comes to pass, so that when it comes to pass, we may believe. "And if thou restore her not, know thou that thou shalt surely die, thou and all that art thine." So I mean, just pretty much just lets them know what's going on. And so already we could get the sense that, the Almighty set this up in order to glorify in Abraham. So, Abraham is probably ignorant of what's taking place. But Abimelech is gonna restore Sarah, and that's gonna come with the price, and it's probably having to do with the Levitical orders, ordinances and statutes and laws and all that, regulations. And so this is how this is how Abraham is gonna acquire great wealth. Well, at least this is like our opinion. And so continuing on forward, "Therefore Abimelech rose early in the morning and called all his servants and told all these things in their ears, and the men were sore afraid." So this is very, very necessary to understand. Nobody would have known anything if Abimelech had not uttered the words that expressed image of the thought of the Almighty put in the mind of Abimelech, so that he may utter those words, and therefore the people feared. They were sore afraid. So, in a sense, Abimelech is fully filling his role and responsibility. He's making known the words that have been presented to him by the Almighty. And so and then it even goes on to say that, he told all these things in the ears. And so, we've kind of spoke something to similar to what we have just read. And so now continuing verse 9, then Abimelech called Abraham and said to him, "What hast thou done to us? And what have I offended thee that thou hast brought on me and on my kingdom a great sin? Thou hast done deeds to me that ought not to be done." And Abimelech said to Abraham, "What sawest thou that thou hast done this thing?" So Abimelech is under the impression that Abraham is a prophet, and in a sense, well, obviously he is, but I in the I personally am not too sure if Abraham has any idea, if he even considers himself a prophet, because he's had visions of the Almighty, but I mean, as far as this situation, we don't get any more revelation as to what's taking place, or at least, or maybe I don't remember. We apologize for that if that happens to be the case, but let us continue so we can find out what's going on. And now, we're gonna spring on over to, okay, verse 11. And Abraham said, "Because I thought," and so this is a thought, we're not sure if this is a thought that the Almighty placed in his mind. At least we can't remember scripture indicating it to be the case, but we know that a thought is the ex is a word, put in the minds of the individuals. But here we're gonna see something really, really not surprising, but really interesting, rather, how the Almighty works, and we can personally kind of relate to this. And so continuing, it says, "What sawest thou that thou hast done this thing?" And Abraham said, "Because I thought, surely the fear of God is not in this place, and they will slay me for my wife's sake." So he thought that Abimelech and his kingdom did not fear or reverence the Almighty. Now, even if that thought happened to be a mistake, I mean, personally, we completely understand and can completely relate to this, because I mean, it could be us doing some wishful thinking, but we never feel that we make mistakes, no matter how bad it gets, because we have faith that thought was in a way put in us via the Almighty, so that mistake could eventually result in the glorification to his purpose, and ultimately serving to the purpose of the Almighty. And we speak of our mistakes. At least that is what we personally testify to, because we honestly never have had a guilty conscience, and that leads us to believe that this is kind of like similar to what's taking place. I mean, Abraham just thought that, I mean, surely these people do not fear the Almighty, and he's being prejudiced. He doesn't even know. But nonetheless, it works out for the ultimate good of the Almighty Creator that is good. And this is kind of we're getting the sense that this is, in a way, the grace being established. Now, if we continue, verse 12 says, "And yet indeed she is my sister. She is the daughter of my father, but not the daughter of my mother." And so he didn't really lie, but he didn't tell the full truth. I guess, I mean, it's not excusable, right? But we clearly see the relationship of grace and the giving up of the law and walking in that grace and in faith and doing away with regulations and legalities and stuff like that, because she is the daughter of my father, and the father, is the one that cometh with grace. But she is not the daughter of my mother. And so, kind of like, she has nothing to do with the law, with the Old Testament Torah. But, we are united in the Father in New Testament in Revelation. And so, we don't have other evidence to back this up, but we, as soon as we read that, it's the first thing that came to mind, that Sarah is a kind of grace, because of Sarah, Abraham's life would be spared. So everywhere they went, Sarah agreed that she would present herself as his brother or sister, my bad, that Sarah would say she was his sister. And so, let us continue reading. Let's see if we get some help here. Now, verse 13, and it came to pass when God caused me to wander from my house, that I said to her, this is thy kindness which thou shalt shew to me at every place whether we shall come, say of me, he is my brother. And so this is the kindness. This is kind of like yeah, this is pretty, this is I mean, we personally accept this to be Abraham walking with grace, in grace, So let us continue on to verse 14. And Abimelech took sheep and oxen and men servants and women servants and gave them to Abraham and restored him Sarah his wife. Now we're not completely sure if what we're about to say is indeed true, but we kind of get the feeling that that in the form in which Abimelech restored Sarah, it's probably under regulation in either Book of Exodus, Book of Deuteronomy, or the Book of Leviticus, because he replaces Sarah with quite a with a substantial amount of gain for Abraham. So, we're pretty sure that there must be some regulations and for Abimelech acting in such a way that he did. So verse 15, and Abimelech said, behold, my land is before thee, dwell where it pleaseth thee. So let us just mention that Abraham is he's coming up, he's getting all kinds of stuff, and it's all going to serve for the purpose of the Almighty. So continuing, it goes on to say, and to Sarah he said, behold, I have given thy brother 1,000 pieces of silver. Now this reminds us of, one shall become a thousand and stuff like that. So this is clearly the grace and mercy of the Almighty, and using Abraham to serve for the ultimate purpose and glorification of the Almighty by multiplying, and these are the beginnings of turning Abraham into a father of nations, leader of nations. So continuing, it reads and it says, behold, he is to thee a covering of the eyes to all that are with thee and with all other. Thus she was reproved. Now the covering of the eyes, I mean, that in itself is interesting, but we're not going to go into more detail, into any detail, to kind of like just conclude with verse 17 and 18. So 17, verse 17, I mean, verse 17, chapter 20 of the book of Genesis, Rastafari Sendbet, study number 4, it reads, so Abraham prayed to God. Now, pay close attention. This is the glorification of the Almighty through Abraham. So Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech and his wife and his maidservants, and they bare children, for the Lord had fast closed up all the wounds of the house of Abimelech because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So now in this chapter we see Abraham the man, Abraham the prophet, and lastly Abraham the savior, the salvation, the healer. It goes back to I and I mentioning healing. But it is really interesting how it all comes to play, comes to come to pass. inevitably, this is the way the Almighty works. Probably Abraham had no idea what was taking place, but you know, even his mistakes serve for the ultimate purpose of the Almighty. And we that, you know, that live in this healthy life, in the Christian life, we know that if we study and learn for ourselves in ways to serve our Creator, then inevitable on I mean my bad in this undertaking of it, we inevitably will find the ways to serve one another, to serve our brothers and sisters within the human community, and you know, and do our part in the ultimate purpose of the Almighty. And we indeed all have a role and responsibility in this motion picture. So, you know, as for I and I glory is in the Bible, says His Imperial Majesty. So we give thanks, and we'll be right back with the third and last part of Rastafari Sandbet study number 4.